Hello everyone, welcome to TravClan's webinar with the German National Tourist Office. First, I would like to apologize from TravClan's behalf. We were delayed by just 10 minutes, but we have Ms. Anika Tandon, the Sales and Marketing Manager at the German National Tourist Office, as well as we have Mr. Romit Theophilus, the Director for India at the German National Tourist Office. And we have for you an amazing and a very interesting presentation about Germany. And over to you, Ms. Anika and Mr. Romit. Please introduce yourself.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you so much for joining today and giving us an opportunity to introduce Germany as a travel destination. I know, during difficult times, nobody could travel much, but then we're giving an opportunity to learn and understand what Germany has to offer. Maybe Romit, if you would want to add something.
Hi, everyone. Thank you for joining us. It's a tough time for all of us when we are at home these days. We appreciate the fact that you take the time out to be on these webinars. We hope in the next hour that we can be able to brief you about what Germany has to offer. If you have any questions at all, please feel free to ask us what it is, even if it has to do with the coronavirus. Whatever your thoughts, we'd be happy to answer those. I'm going to hand over to Anika so she can take you through the presentation of an introduction into what Germany has to offer.
Great. I'll just share my screen with everyone.
Yes. So as Romit told us, if you guys have any questions, you are free to ask all those questions from Ms. Anika herself. Just post your questions into the YouTube comment box. And those of you who are watching via TravClan's website, just post your question down below and we'll be taking each and every questions in detail after the webinar. So Anika, over to you. Please begin.
Great. I hope everybody can see my screen. So, well, to begin with, yes. I would like to start with a presentation with a video in it, wherein, there's a new trend that why not plan now and travel later. So with this, I'll introduce with a small video with you guys so that you'll understand what Germany has to offer as a travel destination.
We are living in unprecedented times. Only in our dreams can we travel. Using the power of our imagination, we can take ourselves wherever we wish. Where are you dreaming of?
I'm dreaming of a hike through unspoilt nature. I'm dreaming of cycling through scenic landscapes. I'm dreaming of riding the waves and of cooling off in the water. I'm dreaming of having fun and living life to the full. I'm dreaming of the adrenaline rush. What are you dreaming of?
I'm dreaming of strolling through medieval lanes and alleyways. I'm dreaming of beautiful towns and captivating cities. I'm dreaming of whiling away the hours in cafes, of tasty street food, and of fine dining. I'm dreaming of epic shopping. I'm dreaming of world-famous attractions and amazing architecture. I'm dreaming of meeting friends and making memories to last a lifetime. What are you dreaming of?
I'm dreaming of regal palaces and fairy tale castles. I'm dreaming of culture and the arts, of theaters and museums, ballet and opera. I'm dreaming of buildings and monuments steeped in history. I'm dreaming of time-honored traditions and customs. I'm dreaming of making new friends and seeing new places. What are you dreaming of?
I'm dreaming of panoramic views and the great outdoors. I'm dreaming of the sun on my face, the wind in my hair. I'm dreaming of soaring mountain peaks and crystal clear lakes. I'm dreaming of the sights and sounds of the forest. I'm dreaming of riverside picnics and walking in the hills. I'm dreaming of windswept moors and endless nature. What are you dreaming of?
Auf Wiedersehen. We can't wait to see you again and to turn your dreams into reality. Destination Germany. Discover Germany from home.
I hope everybody enjoyed the video. So now moving further, I would like to begin with some generic highlight features about Germany. We've always stressed on the fact that Germany is a very affordable destination. Maybe your starting price of a four-star hotel, of course, off-season is somewhere about 80 to 90 euros as compared to other bordering countries, maybe like Austria, Switzerland, or for that matter, France as well, where you end up paying about 120 to 130 euros. Also, there are a lot of times when people, especially young travelers, they want to travel to cities where the cities are very affordable. So we have Berlin as a finest example. Despite being the capital, the hotel price is way, way affordable, especially when you're talking about having a overnight of 50 to 60 euros. So this is basically the affordability which we talk about. When we talk about attractions, Germany has got a plethora of options. And to name a few, we've got the Neuschwanstein Castle, which is in Bavaria, or maybe the English Gardens, which is in Munich, or it could be the Hohenzollern Castle, which is in Southwest Germany. I understand these are all tongue twisters and it's difficult to remember. Of course, we guys are here to help you out in case you guys have any questions. If you are stuck somewhere, we are happy to help you out. Germany is also one of the countries which has no speed limits in few of the autobahns, or what we likely say it as, the highways. Especially for people who would want to self-drive and with their Indian driving license, they don't need any additional international permit. So, driving on the German highways is also one of the luxury driven things where you don't even get to do that on daily basis. Talking about food, a lot of people, especially who are traveling for leisure, they look out for more interesting cuisine options. And Germany has got plenty of restaurants, which of course offer international cuisine. And when we talk about Indian food, Germany has got more than 1,500 Indian restaurants. And to name a few, especially for vegetarians, we've got a lot of options. So vegetarians are actually just not stuck on potatoes. A lot of, 10% of the European population, they've started converting themselves into vegans. So, a lot of options, especially for vegetarians, are there. Germany is known for its shopping as well. And even if I randomly have to call out cities, or maybe each region or a city would have an outlet village. Just to give you an example, maybe we have Metzingen, which is near Stuttgart, or Ingolstadt, which is in Munich, or it could be the MacArthur Glen, which is in Berlin, or for that matter, we have Wertheim Village, which is in Frankfurt. So, you have a lot of outlet villages near these cities. So, but please make sure, when you have your clients, tell them to ask for a VAT-free shopping, which is just to fill a form. And when exiting the country at the airport, they can claim the refund. So even if you get 10 to 12 euros back, which is actually a good thing for us. Also, we have something very, very exciting for kids and the elderly people as well, which is our theme parks. We've got one of the largest now, which is in Europe. That is the Europa Park. It is again located in the southwest part of Germany near Stuttgart, and also closer to Baden-Baden. So in case people who want to stay in theme parks, there are options of 4 to 5 star hotels designed in a form of a Spanish jail or a Colosseum, or could be in a form of a ship. So why not? We always encourage people that just don't go for a one-day trip, at least spend a night in these theme parks. Germany is also famous for its top-notch spas. And one of the famous ones in the world is Baden-Baden. There's a very funny saying that, Baden-Baden is so nice that they had to name it twice. So you all can imagine the world-class wellness options offered in the city, and not only in the city, but of course, within the country. We've got a lot of thermal spas across the country. Well, Germany is also known for adventure, and maybe if you call it as active holidays, one can do hiking, paragliding, or maybe sledging. So next time when you are deciding on a destination which offers both scenic beauty and adventure, So why not? You should consider Germany as one. In the years, we've also seen a trend that Germany is now looked among travelers as a Christmas destination, ranging from Nuremberg, which is in Bavaria, or maybe the Cologne, which is a vibrant city known for Christmas and the oldest and the largest in Frankfurt. So why not plan a trip during the winter time and glaze out the wintry side of Germany? Talking about the scenic routes, we've got more than 200 scenic routes across Germany. I will be talking about these scenic routes in the later half of the presentation. So these scenic routes are also one of the best things one can do, especially when they are driving. Well, this is the slide. You will find out the list of consulates and VFS Pan India. We'll just take a moment. Maybe if people who want to click a picture, they can. Moving further, just to give you a better understanding of the country, especially when people are planning out on a multi-country option. Germany borders Denmark, Poland, Czech, Austria, Switzerland, France, Luxembourg, Belgium, Netherlands, and Denmark. So there are a lot of options. So people, you know, there are a lot of times when people are fiddling what to do, especially when they are in Germany, what countries to visit. So this is just to give you a little background as to how you can plan your travel. And if people are wondering how to go to these countries, yes, we do have 5 international airports within the country, Hamburg, Berlin, Düsseldorf, Frankfurt, and Munich. Also, these countries can be accessed via plane, train, coach, car, or ferry as well. This is just to give you a little fact about that we have got 16 federal states and with our diverse regions. This is the map of Germany. Geographically, I would like you to go through and little understand and give you an idea as to how you can plan your itinerary. So on the northern part, you will see Hamburg. Then on the east is Berlin, the region of Saxony. So a lot of times, you know, people actually come back saying that how do we plan an Eastern European itinerary. So this is something which you can actually do when you are in Berlin or maybe Saxony. You can club it well with Poland or Czech. Then if we go a little down, we have the highest mountain range of Germany, which is Zugspitze, could be clubbed well with Innsbruck or Salzburg. Then we have on the southwest region, we have got the Black Forest Highlands, Stuttgart. Again, if you want to go to Switzerland or France, you can easily club it with these countries. And then the Rhine areas, which is Frankfurt, Düsseldorf, Cologne. So these are a lot of options one can do. So it was just to give you a little brief as to how you can plan and route your itineraries. Moving further, to make it more clear and crisp, I would like you all to take a trip starting from Frankfurt. So most of the people already know that Frankfurt has the largest, third largest airport, which is named as Fraport. We generally recommend a night in Frankfurt where one can see one of the Frankfurt's main attraction, which is called the Museum Embankment. So basically it's a series of riverside museums. Then we have got the Frankfurt Old Town, which is also well known for its rich and colorful history. Then we've got the Römer or the City Hall, which is known for its cobbled street and the old timber houses. And definitely, which is not to be missed, which is the Frankfurt Applewine Express and how the locals call it as the Applewine Express. It's basically a historical tram and one can explore the city on this express within hour-long music, pretzels, and a Frankfurt cider or maybe an apple juice. In the past, you know, I just want to share a little story that in the past people have come back with strange stories saying that when our clients were on this Applewine Express, it was more of a drinking tour rather than a city tour. So just make sure that, you know, people, they don't have more than a glass of cider because it gets onto your head. So that's something which I wanted to share with you. Okay, moving further, now we head towards Cologne, which is just by train, 1 hour, 30 minutes, and by car, it's roughly 2 hours. Cologne is one of the very interesting and vibrant cities, which is famous for its eau de Cologne. Also, if you have small groups or large groups and they're visiting Cologne, make sure that they visit the House of 4711, where one can buy or even try making their own eau de Cologne. So it actually works well when you have small groups or the big groups, especially for incentives. Then we have got the Cologne Cathedral, which you'll see in the background. It's one of the UNESCO World Heritage Sites. We have the largest carnival, which happens in the city of Cologne, which is called the Cologne Carnival. Then it's famous for its chocolate museum. So Germans are very clever. We have the chocolate museum. Right next to the chocolate museum, we have the gym. So eat more chocolates and then get into the gym and burn calories. And then, of course, our Christmas market. So in case if you have your clients who want to go and explore the Christmas market, so Cologne could be one of the options as well. And it is also the starting point of your Rhine, which is your Rhine River. So one can actually do trips on these river cruises. Now we head towards Düsseldorf by train. It's half an hour, and by car, it's 40 minutes. Well, it's actually not necessary that, one actually has to take a train or car. It's just to give you a little idea that, you know, by road or by train, Germany is very much accessible between the cities. Moving to Düsseldorf, it's known for its fashion industry, and it's divided by the Rhine River with its old town on the west and the commercial areas on the east. So, you know, one can actually do boat trips also on the Rhine River. And every city actually has a very striking residence. So one of the palaces, which is in Düsseldorf, is the Castle Bernhard. And in case if nothing has been planned in Düsseldorf, one really don't know what to do. So we also have the longest bar in the world, which actually has 260 bars and restaurants in one line, which is in the old town. So people who are also interested in doing skiing or sledging. So we do have the Jever Fun Ski Halle, which is right in the city center. Now we move ahead to Hamburg, which is 4 hours by train, and by car it's just half an hour more. Very interesting. I would definitely recommend at least a night or a two in Hamburg, because there are a lot of places one can actually visit. Especially we've got one of the most popular
Anika, yeah. just a small remark. A lot of the audience is actually asking for a bit slower pace. So if you could just like slow down a bit in terms of the pace.
Thank you. So when it comes to the Hamburg quarter, we've got the entertainment quarter, which actually hosts number of bars, pubs, and discotheques. We also have the miniature Wonderland, which is basically for the entertainment for kids. It's a model railway with guided tours. Then just like Düsseldorf, we can actually do boat trips on Alster Lake. And interestingly, if people who are interested in concerts or operas, then one can also visit the largest concert hall, which is the Elbphilharmonie. Next, we move ahead to Berlin, which is just 2 hours by train, and by car, it's just another half an hour, and easily could be clubbed well with, as I said, Poland or Czech. It's a direct train from Berlin, and from Dresden, if you see, it's a 1 hour journey. Also, one of the very vibrant cities, very young city. We've got a lot of popular sites within the city, which has Brandenburg Gate, Berlin Wall, Checkpoint Charlie, and people who are interested in museums. We also have a series of museum islands within the city. For example, Madame Tussauds Museum, or for kids, we've got the Legoland Discovery Center. Talking about the party, the nightlife, yes, Berlin is one of the cities which has got 24/7 party culture. So if you have your clients who really don't know what to do, of course, they can actually end up sipping a beer in one of the bars, or they can do pub hopping or bar hopping. It also has one of the largest stage shows, which is called the Friedrichstadtpalast, which is very much similar to the Lido show in Paris. But especially to big groups who wants to make reservations, they have to make reservations very well in advance, because a lot of times the bookings or the availability is really a matter. So make sure that, you know, everything is well planned in advance. Now we move ahead to Dresden, which is the region of Saxony. A lot of the times people have come back saying that Saxony, what all places are there to visit in Saxony. I would definitely recommend that, you know, one should actually make a halt or maybe a one night in Leipzig. And maybe when it comes to Dresden, then one should actually spend at least an overnight or two in Dresden. So I've listed down the distance between Berlin to Leipzig and Berlin to Dresden, which is 2 hours, 15 minutes, and by car, it's just 2 hours. So Dresden is one of the iconic places for honeymooners and for travelers who have profound interest in art and architecture. So if you see in the background, the picture itself, it's the famous skyline of Dresden. One can also do a steamboat ride through Dresden Elbe Valley. It also has a great, huge Indian Connect, which is the Court of Aurangzeb, which is in the Greenwald Treasury Museum. then people who are interested to see the scenic side of Saxony, or for that matter Dresden, then one can actually take a half an hour drive to this Saxon-Switzerland National Park, which is famous for its Basta rock formation, or which is also called as the Flat Table Mountains. So definitely people who are interested for hiking, one can actually visit the Saxon-Switzerland National Park. It's a must go. Like already mentioned, every city has a castle. So one of the very famous ones in Dresden itself is the famous hunting palace, which is called the Moritzburg Castle. Then we move ahead and we go directly to Stuttgart. You'll be amazed to see by train, it takes 7 hours, and by car, it just takes 5.5 hours. So that's also one of the very interesting things one can do, that, you know, in case, you know, you are time constrained, you don't want to travel by train. So why not just pick up a car and drive? And of course, the drive should not be missed, because it actually takes you through medieval villages, towns. So it's very scenic.
Nick, I'm just going to interrupt you here. For people, I just want to let you know that Berlin to Munich, there's a new train that started. It takes about 4 hours. It's a high-speed train. Instead of doing this seven-hour journey by from Dresden to Stuttgart, I would suggest that you make a stop off in the city of Munich and then go, because you'd break your journey quite easily, and it would it's about 2.5 hours from Dresden to Munich and another 3.5 hours from Munich to Stuttgart. So, and Munich's a is a fantastic city. I'm guessing Anika will talk about that a little later. And the best way to do this, instead of going from Dresden to Stuttgart, is to go from Dresden to Munich and then Munich to Stuttgart. Thanks, Anika.
Okay, now moving further. To begin, even to start further about talking about the city of Stuttgart, there are a lot of times that people come back asking that which one is better. Is it Mercedes-Benz Museum, which is in Stuttgart, or maybe which is the best in BMW, which is in Munich? Definitely, if you're asking, my personal favorite is the Mercedes-Benz Museum. Of course, I'm not saying that you should not go to the BMW Welt as well. But yes, the Mercedes Museum itself, it's so appealing that it's actually built in a form of a racing track. So that's something which is very enticing, especially travelers who have come back seeing the Mercedes-Benz Museum. So yes, when we talk about Stuttgart, it's home to the world famous automobile museums. We have Porsche Museum, and then we have, of course, the Mercedes-Benz Museum. It's also known as one of the finest, fabulous wine regions in the country. So like I just mentioned about Metzingen, which is just half an hour from Stuttgart. So one can actually drive through all these vineyards. It's one of the finest locations one can actually see. It also hosts one of the second largest beer festival after Oktoberfest, which is the Cannstatter Beer Festival. Again, it happens in the month of August, September. Moving further, now we directly drive ahead to the Black Forest area, which is Baden-Baden. If you see, it's just 1 hour, 20 minutes drive approx. I've already mentioned about Baden-Baden. It's one of the luxury spa towns. It's also, we've also got two of the finest luxurious spas, which is the Caracalla Spa and the historic Roman Bad, which is called the Friedrichsbad. So definitely people who are interested in living a luxury life, so Baden-Baden should be considered one of the options. It also has one of the oldest, beautiful, and the world's largest beautiful casino in the world, which is again called as Baden-Baden Casino. But please make sure, if you have your guest who wants to go to this casino, men have to be in their best of the tuxedos and girls have to be in their pretty dresses. Only then the entry is allowed. Rest, if you talk about outdoor activities, Baden-Baden also has hiking, golfing, water sports, and paragliding as well. So people who are actually, they really have a lot of time to spend in the city, one can also do a horse carriage ride and they can explore the city on it. So that's something which is very interesting, and I would definitely recommend at least an overnight in Baden-Baden as well. Next, we move ahead to Black Forest. I'm sure a lot of people, they are already aware. Black Forest is known for its Black Forest cake, and it's also home to the cuckoo clock. But my personal recommendation would be that, you know, if you are already in Black Forest and you have time and you really don't know what to do, so it would be better that, you know, you have to rent a car, because sometimes depending on the public transport is kind of time constrained. So I would definitely say that if you have your own car, or you have a chauffeur-driven car, just make the best use of it, because the town itself is a lot of picture seeking, and it's got one of the stunning landscapes in Germany. So if you have your own car, you're really at ease when you're driving in Black Forest region. Moving ahead, so this is something which I wanted to talk, because, you know, we've started our journey from Frankfurt Airport, and then we would like to end our journey at the Munich Airport. So now we come head to Munich, which is by train 4 hours, 30 minutes, and by car, it's approximately 4 hours. Munich is also known as the capital city of Bavaria, again, the beer capital, and it's also home to one of the largest beer festivals in the world, which is Oktoberfest. Oktoberfest happens in September, but not in October, but it ends in the first week of October. It's also a gateway to the Alps. And if you have time in Munich, just make sure that, you know, especially for football fans, one should go and visit Allianz Arena. Then we have got Nymphenburg Castle. Also, we've got the Munich Residence and the BMW World or the BMW Museum. So please make sure that, you know, you're just not going to Mercedes-Benz Museum, but also doing a tour of BMW Museum as well. There are a lot of times that people actually have come back saying that one has time and what to do from Munich. Are there any cities to be covered from Munich? Definitely, one can actually visit, do day excursions from Munich. Could be the Neuschwanstein Castle, which is the Disney's inspiration castle, which is in Füssen, just 45 minutes drive. Or maybe the highest mountain peak, which is Zugspitze, or the Christmas town, which is Nuremberg, or maybe the Hitler's town, which is Berchtesgaden. And we also have the shopping outlet village, which is again just 40 minutes from Munich, is called the Ingolstadt. So there are a lot of places or a lot of things one can do when they are in Munich. Now we'll head to the highest mountain range, which is the Zugspitze. And the base area to go to Zugspitze is Garmisch. However, from Garmisch, you have to take a train to go to Eibsee, and then from Eibsee, you take a cogwheel to go to Zugspitze. So that's how one can reach Zugspitze. So I've mentioned the distance. It's by cogwheel from Garmisch, it's 1 hour 15 minutes, and by cogwheel train to from Eibsee is 40 minutes. That's one of the highlights which I would like to mention, that Zugspitze offers a 362 days of snow experience. So those 3 days, if you don't get snow, so then you know that you're actually at the wrong time of the year in Zugspitze. But yes, it offers a snow experience all around the year. It also offers 4-country panorama view, which is Germany, Austria, Switzerland, and Italy. And it's also the highest peak in German Alps and also the highest chapel of the world. So yes, you know, definitely it's a recommendation when you are in the region of in Bavaria, or maybe, you know, when you are in Innsbruck, then why not take a visit to Zugspitze as well. Next, we directly head to, we end our journey to Munich Airport. So in case if you have missed your flight and you really don't know what to do, then, you know, why not spend your time and just shop around the downtown prices at the Munich Airport. It's also got one of the world's only airport brewery, which is called the Airbrau. So that's also one of the very interesting things one can do when they have time to explore the Munich Airport. And it's also ranked among the top 4 airports after Frankfurt worldwide. Well, mentioning about the scenic routes, we've got almost more than 200 scenic routes. Of course, I would not be talking all the scenic routes in this presentation, but yes, just to give you an idea, we've got the Cheese Road, we've got the German Fairy Tale Road, Romantic Road, the Wine Road. There are a lot of routes one can actually see. But to talk in a brief, I have listed down a few of the important routes one can actually do, and especially people who wants to do self-drive and they want to explore the finest cities of the country. So I've mentioned about the towns, which is along the Romantic Road. And if you see, the driving time between each city is 40 minutes to 1 hour. And it is actually not necessary that you have to stay in all these cities. Maybe you can just make a halt at a few of the cities and overnight in one or two. For example, you know, like Rothenburg ob der Tauber, I would definitely say that, you know, if you're already in this tour, why not stay at least an overnight in Rothenburg ob der Tauber, which is one of the romantic towns and known for its cobbled street. Also, if you happen to visit Augsburg during Christmas time, so make sure that you are already staying in Augsburg, because it's also known as one of the finest Christmas towns. And of course, not to be missed, the Füssen, which is known for its Neuschwanstein Castle, which was an inspiration to Disney. So this is basically the entire routing one can do when they are driving along the romantic road. And if you see, the driving time between each city is just 40 minutes to 1 hour, 30 minutes. Moving further, I guess we've all grown up hearing the Cinderella stories or the Sleeping Beauty Castle. So all these stories actually have come from Germany, the fairy tale road. Again, the driving time between each city is just 40 minutes to 2.5 hours. Like I said, it's not necessary that one has to stay in all these cities, make a halt and drive along and stay in other cities. But definitely not to be missed is Kassel, Hamelin and Bremen. It's again the old medieval villages, quaint towns. So one can actually see a lot of picturesque towns. Lastly, this is something, you know, especially for first-time travelers or people who really want to explore the other side of Germany. So I've just listed down this best German itinerary one can explore. We'll start with Berlin. So this, I've already spoken about Berlin. This is the evening view of the Brandenburg Gate and 24/7 party culture. This is the skyline of Dresden. Then our typical brewery, the Beer Gardens at Munich, which definitely should not be missed. And this is Lake Constanz. Well, this is also another interesting site. It is bordered by Austria and Switzerland. It is also it also has the largest lake in Germany, and one can actually do water sports. Also, the area is famous for its old castles and quaint medieval villages. So in case if you have your clients who are already in Switzerland and they really don't know what to do and they want to still come back to Germany, so why not make a visit here in Lake Constanz, because it also offers a lot of variety of boutique and four-star hotels within the city. That's Black Forest. The moment you enter the city, you know that you are already in the town of Cuckoo Clocks. Rothenburg Ob der Tauber, which is famous for, it's called the Romantic City. It's known for its cobbled street. Then we've got the Heidelberg. This also is the start of the Rhine area. One who is interested to do something different in Heidelberg, one can actually take a funicular railway and they can move on the top of the Heidelberg Castle. This is the largest bridge and the oldest bridge in Germany in Heidelberg. Then we have the River Rhine area, which is called Mainz, known for its medieval castles, quaint villages. So one can actually do Rhine River cruises from these areas. And you can actually see one of the picture-seeking sites of this town. Finally, that was the end of the presentation. I hope people have understood quite a bit about what Germany has to offer, especially when you have your small groups, FITs or leisure, or maybe MICE. There are a lot of things one can actually do when you happen to plan your trip to Germany. Lastly, I would like to say that we have for you is the specialist program. That is www.germanyspecialist.com. Please register yourself, and after completing all four modules, you would be entitled to be a Destination Germany expert. So in case, you know, just to maybe, I might have missed out on something which you would want to understand, maybe just get onto this website and be a specialist of Germany. Well, if you need more information, log on to www.germany.travel. I know it's not the right time to say that, let's go to Germany, let's meet you in Germany. But yes, we look forward to meeting you in Germany sometime soon. Thank you so much. The forum is now open for questions. So we guys are here, Romit is here, we all can answer in case if you have anything.
Yes, I think we have a couple of questions from YouTube over here. And I think it's time we can stop sharing the screen so that we can have a discussion. And rightly said, this is probably not the right time to say travel to Germany, but we know for sure the travel industry will definitely rebound and we'll come back even stronger than before. So I have a couple of questions from
One second, Tarang, before we get into that. Our new campaign, Discover Germany from Home, is something that we'd like you all to have a look at. The video Anika showed you is something we encourage you to share on your timelines or on your company's social media pages as well. The whole idea is that discover, dream now, travel later. So we do look forward at some point to welcome you in Germany, but right now we would like you to discover Germany from home. I would also recommend that everybody get an opportunity, if you haven't already, to be a German specialist. We're doing quite a lot of things. We have a virtual German travel mart, which will happen in June. We will be taking some Indian tour operators for this virtual travel mart live, and you can actually interact with German buyers, such as hotels, hotels, tourism offices, cruises, and other touristic activities. This will happen at the end of June. It is only for a select few, so it's being done on a first-come, first-served basis. So do keep this in mind, and of course, we will continue to do more and more webinars, Romit, as the year progresses.
Will it be possible for you to show the campaign that you're talking about on screen?
It's basically the same video that Anika has already shared.
Okay.
That's what we are doing, and we've broken that video into four smaller videos so that we can share that on social media. So if anybody wants that, we can send that across to them.
Okay. So should we move on to the questions?
Please.
Yes. So we have some questions from the YouTube channel. So the first question is around the Indian food availability in the Dusseldorf region. So are there any Indian restaurants, and what
there are many there are many Indian restaurants in all across Germany, about 1500 to 2000, as I mentioned. Talking about Dusseldorf, yes, there are quite a few in Dusseldorf as well, so you can find Indian food quite easily in Dusseldorf. When it comes to having it catered in your hotel, you'll have to check with which hotel you're staying in. I don't always recommend the kitchen caravan service, which a lot of people do, but I always recommend going to a restaurant or getting it catered for small groups or individuals as such. Okay. So Indian food is not an issue there.
Okay. Ms. Swetil Mulam is asking that, can we do hiking trails in Black Forest region?
Yes, you can do hiking not only in the Black Forest, but all in many places in Germany. But since this is more relevant to the Black Forest, you can do many things in the Black Forest. Hiking is just one of the adventure things. And I recommend if your clients or you are fond of hiking, do a hike in this region, see the crystal clear lakes, look at the hills with the clouds coming across. I mean, it's quite a picturesque area to be in.
Okay.
And in this region, I would always recommend farm stays or home stays wherever possible, especially for smaller groups. I'm not talking about large groups, but for FITs, I would recommend that. It just gives you an idea of living in a rustic feel.
Okay. The next question is regarding the MICE. So do we have any special incentives or offers for MICE groups or travel agents doing MICE groups for Germany?
No, unfortunately, we do not have any specific incentives as such. What we do recommend is that we do have all the infrastructure in place in many of the big cities, whether it be Munich, it be Cologne, it be Berlin, which can cater to any of these groups, including Indian food, including excursions, for example, from Munich to Zugspitze, where you can go on the mountain peak and host 2,000 people over there as well. But we don't do incentives as such. So incentives to tour operators as such, we're booking these groups. But any help you need in terms of coordination, we're happy to do that. Put you in touch with, for example, the Munich airport, the Frankfurt airport, who can be useful to you, touristic services like Berlin Tourism Department or the Munich Tourism Department. We also have a MICE Congress Federation, which we can put you in touch with. So there are quite a few areas where we can put you in touch with people, but for specific incentives to tour operators, there are none in Germany.
Okay. So, you know, talking about MICE again, Nitya Mehra is asking that, are there any unique venues for MICE gala dinners? Would you like to shed some light on that? Any unique venues related to, you know, MICE groups?
You know, it actually depends on what you like. I mean, you can do something 200 feet under the ground and at the salt mines next to the border with Austria. You can do the Zugspitze, which is Germany's tallest mountain. You can even at times rent out the car museums. Beer gardens, bar museums as well. But you have to do all this in advance. If you try and do this last minute, you won't get a lot of the venues. So there are a lot of quite exciting things. Old factories which have been converted into incentive venues or nightclubs which you can use. There are quite a few in Germany, actually.
Okay. Coming next on to the extreme adventure sport options in Germany. So could you throw some light on some extreme adventure sports options available for travelers?
I mean, there's everything. I mean, you can do, you can jump off a World War II plane if you like, and paraglide, parachute. There's cliff diving, there's cliff jumping. There's quite a lot that you can do in all over Germany. The good part is that 75% of the country is nature or green, and only 25% is really the cities. So there's, for extreme adventures, there's a lot of things that you can do. Cliff diving is one of them. You can climb mountains as well. There's, parachuting, paragliding, whatever you can think of, it can be done in Germany, including a lot of options for snow as well. So you can do a lot of things.
Okay. The next question is from Mr. G.H. Zaidi. He's asking that after this COVID-19 situation that we all are struggling in, how and when it will be safe for Indian nationals to travel to Germany? And are there any additional or new formalities coming up regarding the travel to Germany?
I mean, I would, for the latest information, if you go to germany.travel, which is our website, you'll find the latest information for the coronavirus. It would be wrong for me to say that it would be, we could welcome tourists as soon as next month or the month after that, because we don't know. This, unfortunately, we don't know what restrictions will be in place. We don't know if you'd need a health certificate at this point of time. However, the first people we will inform is the trade as soon as we have clarity on this. Whenever Germany opens up, we will inform the trade that yes, Germany's opened up. Because at this point of time, even Germany is under a lockdown. And they're slowly looking at reopening. They're not going to do it in a mass. And tourism is unfortunately not on the agenda at this point of time, but in the near future, it will be. So I can't say whether it would be 1 week or 1 month or 6 months for that matter. We don't know at this moment. But as soon as we get more clarity on the picture, we will, of course, share it with the travel trade. And I would request people to go to germany.travel and have a look at the COVID information, which is present there, because that'll give you an update. I mean, even if you want to see it on a weekly basis.
Okay. What is the best time of the year to visit Germany?
Anika, I think you should take that one. She mentioned the all year round destination.
There's a lot of times now people have started coming back to us saying that winter is one of the best times one can do. But yes, when we talk about the best time, it's somewhere from May to August is what we recommend to our travelers.
Well, we recommend that because it's warmer. That's the only reason we recommend that. But honestly, Christmas markets happen from November onward. We have the Oktoberfest in September to October. You have the carnival season, which begins in February. I mean, you can go anytime. Germany, depends on where you're going, has got something or the other going around. At one point, there was a campaign that we ran, which was 1 million events in Germany every year. So there's something happening depending where you're going. So it's an all-year-round destination. It just depends on what you'd like to do. If you like to go when it's a little warmer, yes, me too. August is the best time to go for a slightly warmer season. If you like the winters, you can go anytime from October to March. So it's an all-year-round destination. It all depends what you want to do.
Okay. And one of our viewers actually is questioning about the German specialist program login. Yes. He's facing some difficulties regarding that. So would you like to list?
Yeah, absolutely. If you're facing any problems, if anyone's having any issue, if you can send us a short email, I'm going to give you Anika's email ID, because mine to spell it out will be a slight disaster. It's anika.tandon@germany.travel.
We'll be sharing those details with all the attendees after the webinar.
Sounds good. And if you already have my email ID and you're facing any issue, just let me know and I'm happy to take it forward and we'll get it sorted for you.
Okay. Just give me a second. The next question is... just give me a second. So, yes, how many nights are sufficient? I know Germany is... huge country and you cannot probably explore the entire country. But yes, what is the minimum nights you suggest for an FIT booking problem?
Maybe for a first time traveler, we will generally recommend a 4-nighter or 5-nighter, not more than that.
Okay.
That's something which we would recommend. But yes, for a regular traveler, I guess 10 nights is also less because it totally depends what the person has to do. But yes, when we are talking about FITs or small groups, I would definitely recommend a 4-nighter, 5-nighter, maybe starting from Southwest Germany and ending their trip in the Bavarian region. So that's something which we can...
I'll be honest with you. Every time I've taken a trip, and I've gone quite often privately to Germany, I have a 3-year-old son and I took him to, and I really wanted him to see Europa Park. So started off in Frankfurt, spent a night and a half, two nights in Frankfurt, went off to Baden-Baden, spent two nights there, spent four nights in Europa Park, which seemed less also, and then went into the Black Forest and spent a night or two in Freiburg. It's lovely, these areas. And Europa Park is a must-do park. It's got, the lines are lesser than what you'd find in Euro Disney, for example. The price is quite considerably less than what you would pay for Euro Disney. So I would recommend Europa Park, not only for the affordability aspect, but the fact that it is a great theme park as well, especially for people with kids from anywhere from. I mean, my son was 2.5 when we took him. But the people who go there, I mean, I know young children at the age of 40 are still going there. So
even my age, I can, if given a chance, I can go again and like stay there for at least two nights in within the theme park.
Yeah.
It's
okay.
Very big, yeah.
Okay, so a question related to our elderly. So when we talk about our elderly travelers who visit Germany, for them, do we have any facility of Hindi-speaking guides who can assist them and guide them better?
Yes, in certain areas, yes. I can't really comment and say that, yes, all over Germany, but I know, for example, in the region of Saxony, we have a Hindi-speaking guide. I think she speaks Hindi and Tamil, for that matter. Maybe some of you have met her. Her name is Seema. But Seema can actually travel anywhere in Germany and be with you. She's an Indian lady who lives in Dresden. Okay. And she can actually be anywhere in Germany that you need her to be. So I would say yes, that you do have the opportunity for Hindi-speaking guides, or even not only Hindi, but other languages as well. And at times you also get a lot of German students who've learned Indian languages. So sometimes they are also available as guides.
Okay, great. So moving forward, I'd like to introduce Mr. Ramanpreet Singh here, and he'll be asking a couple of questions to both of you. Hi, Raman, how are you?
I'm good, Tarang. Thank you so much. Thank you, Anika, and thank you, Romit, for such a wonderful session. First of all, I would like to apologize. Why? Because there was some technical glitches. The technology is not human, so they don't have emotions, but we do. So... okay, now I have been asked a question, you know, unless like Europe, would there be any pass people can take where they can travel through buses, coaches, you know, and it's because moving forward, this market will be price sensitive. So there'll be a lot of millennials who will start traveling, and it's one of the best destination to explore. So would you like to give any recommendation what they can do?
You know, we have different city passes. We don't have a German country pass as such. I mean, we have a German rail pass, yes. But for buses and coaches, we do recommend that you look at the, for example, you'll have a Stuttgart city card or a Berlin welcome card or a Munich city card. Different cities have their own cards, which give you public transport, the S-Bahn, for example, which is the metro line there, and buses, of course, are included, as well as quite a few discounts or free museum entries as well. So we recommend all of these passes. Even in the Black Forest, you have the Black Forest Highland Pass, which is there as well. So you have different passes all over, and I would recommend whichever city you're going to have a look at getting the individual pass. We unfortunately don't have a pass that covers the whole country, but yes, we do have passes individually that people can look at doing. Also, just a little tip, we have this thing called Flixbus in Germany, and Flixbus is one of the best ways to get around from city to city.
Okay.
It's quite cheap. So talking about price sensitive, I mean, I think you can get from, sometimes you get even 10 euros from, for example, from Berlin to Munich. So it all depends when you book and what offers are going on, but they're quite cheap as well. So have a look at those as well.
Okay. The next question that I have, basically, you know, post-COVID situation, eventually people will have less money to spend, but they will be eager to traveling, right? So there could be a situation that five-star customer may go to four-star and four-star customer may go to three-star, or three-star customer may opt for sharing accommodation concept like Airbnb. What is the kind of occupancy that we have in Germany, and would you like to just share some views on it?
Well, if there's no trade fair going on and if there is no major festival, Germany has enough hotel rooms to accommodate everyone, no matter how many people are going. I'd also like to recommend something that, you know, we have a lot of hotels which are no-frill hotels in Germany, like Motel One, the Meininger hotels, for example. These are a few of them which are no-frill hotels, which means that it's like a four-star hotel, but you don't have room service, for example. You may not have a warm breakfast, but you're allowed to use, in certain of these hotels, you're allowed to use the kitchen. For example, A&O's hostels, they call it, but it's A&O gives you these wonderful single rooms, which is like a four-star hotel, but no room service. You may not have a phone in your room either, but you get the basic room with the TV, and it's quite cheap. So there are a lot of options in Germany for budget travelers and for people wanting to save money. And as Anika mentioned, the affordable factor of Germany versus many of our neighboring countries, Germany does stand out to be quite affordable, even in the four-star segment.
And, you know, before the COVID situation, there was a lot of boom coming up for women's travel. So I know Germany is one of the safest places to be around the world. But any recommendation or any itinerary suggestion that you would like to give, especially for women travel?
You know, honestly, like you rightly mentioned, Germany is safe for women travelers. We've had stories of people, even Indian women, spending the night on train stations because they couldn't get a room somewhere in Germany. But Germany is quite safe for anybody. I mean, you can go any place, anytime. Germany is very safe.
Okay.
I mean, Anika, as a woman, I'm sure you could probably give some insights on the safety aspect of Germany.
To be honest, I women staying on the train station. So it's personally me. I actually missed my train, so we actually had to stay like an overnight at the train station. So yes, it is quite safe. And then, you know, I don't have a particular city in mind where a woman can go, but then maybe you can just pick and choose a city and you can think of going there, because it's
quite safe. Germany all around is a safe destination for women and children. So, I mean, it's not a destination where I would suggest that you worry. Of course, stray incidents happen everywhere, but relatively, Germany is quite safe.
And people are friendly. So even if you're lost, English is actually not a problem. So even, you know, people who don't know German, so they can easily survive in the country and they can't just easily get lost. So, yes.
Yeah, it's easy to talk to people. You know, a lot of times, even if, let's say, the older generation doesn't know English, a lot of times I've had the situation where I'm talking to an older person asking for directions, and they've always been helpful, even though we don't speak the same language. They're speaking German, I'm speaking English, but they've always pointed me to the right direction I need to go in. So people are quite friendly.
All right. And just the question, I think you've answered it, but I'd just like to ask. Is there an official website where people can find different languages guides? Probably somebody wants to find a Hindi speaking guide or different languages speaking guides. On your official website, is that information?
No, there isn't. But I mean, you can send us an email. We'll try and help you out where we can. Seema is the one official guide that comes to India as well with Saxony Tourism at times. And she is someone that you can always refer to. So we're happy to give you Seema's information, and when and where we can keep updating this list, we will.
Okay. I think, Tarang, you already asked about the training module and the German expert program, which we've already mentioned, right? Okay. Yes. Somebody just asked, will there be any additional benefit in terms of if I be a German expert?
Well, apart from knowledge, the whole idea of the expert program is actually knowledge. But yes, we do give preference on study tours that we take. We do invite people to more events that we do, such as the roadshows in different countries. We do prefer people who are part of the German Specialist Program for many of our activities that we plan. So there is that benefit as such. It's not something that can be measured in terms of a monetary thing, but there are benefits where we look at taking people on study tours, especially people who are German specialists. We invite them to our roadshows and our events that we do. And we try and keep good contact with them as well, and try and assist them wherever we can.
The last question I want to ask, and then I would like to wind up from my end. I have a very close friend. He just keep on bothering me on WhatsApp, saying that please ask my question. So he's basically has a travel company, but he's also a committee member of the lot of universities across in India. So what he does is basically he try and plans out a small tours for students within the age of 18 to 25, where they can learn about a destination, economic factors, about tourism, So what he does is he take them to a journey which is about close by, but he was planning out for a longer long haul destinations. So his requirements are where professors can give a basic lecture about the economics, about the tourism for half an hour. And there can be university visits, there can be factory visits, which can help them in terms of build up their resume. And once they come back to India, they're more equipped to. Yeah,
so what we can do for the gentleman, I mean, we have many agents who are doing this in India, to be frank. Mm-hmm. What we can do is the same thing that we've done for them, is that we can try and put them contact with tour operators in Germany who specialize in these kind of things and can help with factory visits, university visits, lectures from professors, things like that. So we can definitely put them in touch with the right people.
Great. So that's all from my end, Tarang, and over to you, Romit. Thank you, Anika, for being here.
I would like to ask one last question, which I think is it is one of my favorite questions to ask from everyone, like who's a destination expert. So my question for both of you is, if you want to summarize the entire destination in just three things, so what, according to you, will be the USP for Germany?
Affordability. Okay. I would say beauty, whether it be landscape or just natural beauty of the place. And lastly, I would say safety and friendliness. Some three words are very difficult, but safety, friendliness, beauty is what I would definitely put in there.
Okay, Janika, would you like to add something?
I would just say Germany as a travel destination. I think that's so true.
Well, if you see any of our logos, you'd see that we do have three words. Germany simply inspiring, Germany the travel destination. So.
I guess just to make it a little crisp, I think that's the best. But yeah, rightly Roman said, I guess it's full of nature. Like, people compare countries with Switzerland, Austria. But yes, Germany has got a lot of, 70% of sustainability and green parks around the country.
Right.
That's very scenic.
Okay. This has been great. Thank you, Roman, and thank you, Anika, for this lovely presentation. Thank you each and every person who participated and attended this webinar. For attending this webinar, I had so much fun, and thank you so much for this interesting presentation. We'll be reaching out to each and every participant via email, in which we'll be giving you the entire presentation as well as the contact details of Miss Anika herself, and you can connect with her
If I could just trouble you, Tarang, do share mine as well. So that would be great.
Okay, great. So we'll be sharing the contact details of both Mr. Romit and Ms. Anika. And that's all from our side. Thank you so much for attending today's webinar. Hope to see you in our next webinar, that is on 4th of May, the details of which will be live on the events forum of Traflan. Thank you so much. That's all from our end. And bye-bye. Thank you.
Thank you, guys. Thank you so much.
Cheers, guys. Bye-bye.